Welcome. We continue our series of open lectures, very great series this day, with a lecture in French, you know, which is not so wrong in this part of the world. You know, French seems to be an accepted language here. But anyway, most of us will not be able to understand French, therefore we did something we thought should be okay, trying to have a translation. But it turned out quite an adventure. You know, the original translator, Alan Shapiro, was killed in action. as you all know, he seems to suffer a nervous breakdown and left the school, you know. And his wife, who typed it in, also disappeared. The only trace left was a diskette in my mailbox in the morning, which was given us the first draft of the first draft of this translation. And then Avital and Pablo generously jumped in and tried to make some sense out of the translation, which turned out quite a thing. You know, after 2 hours, I heard Avital say that she will now leave here. So at the end, it said it's a revised version. No, it's not a revised version. These two translators will reject all responsibility. It's a try to a revision, and the first pages may still have this, but then they gave kind of up and just tried to find something they could use. Anyway, I believe it will not hurt, you know, because we have the writer here. Mm-hmm. And he is capable enough to tell us what he wants to say then in the discussion, if we don't get it by reading. As Jean-Luc Nancy, I don't need to introduce him. Just let me say for a moment why I invited him. I invited him certainly because Avital said, if I have to invite a French philosopher, then it should be Jean-Luc Nancy, the most inspiring person France has after the big guys, you know, the old guys.
I'm not that young.
the guys who are not coming to the school because it's slave work, as I heard, you know, so slave work for them. Okay, that may be true. But anyway, Jean-Luc Nancy is a very rare case even for a philosopher because of the scope of his interest. You know, trained in German literature, you know, trained in French philosophy. His interest is from literature and poetry to political questions, to question of religion, all these things. And he doesn't do it in kind of separate enterprises. They all get related in him as a person, and that has quite very surprising gemisch in German, you know, it's a melange, right, a melange. And that. So that is the way how new ideas are born, by relating things, connecting things nobody else would actually do. And therefore we are looking forward to hear something about deconstruction Christianity on the 100th death day of Friedrich Nietzsche. So now we can revise.
And the assumption,
whatever. It's so much Christianity here, you know, just, but also, you know, I am an atheist. I have no idea what this whole thing is about, you know, so, but I hope he will convince me that there's still reason to investigate and revisit Christianity. All right.
You know, if you say you are an atheist, it means you are a Christian.
Yeah. No, I mean
that I will.
No, you told him not. He's totally right. I'm a non-theist. Non-theist, if there is a word for that.
This is what I want to demonstrate. Well, thank you. Wolfgang and Avital for inviting me to join this experience of the European Graduate School. which I am very happy to share now almost for 1 week, and to share with a great interest and happiness. Well, and thank you to Alan, who unfortunately must leave, and to Avital and Pablo for taking this not very easy task of translating. Well, but it was not too much, because according to the suggestion of Wolfgang himself, I prepared only not exactly a lecture, but something which will be short, only 30 minutes about, and which it is intended to work as an introduction or a kind of summary, working as well as a kind of abstract of one aspect of the seminar I am doing with the first of the two classes. And so, which is intended more to open a discussion after a half hour than to give the whole elaboration of a lecture, I mean, like the Avital's lecture, for example. And now I start in French, and you can follow the surely excellent translation. The déconstruction du christianisme. Au moment où l'Occident ne peut plus s'appeler l'Occident, puisqu'il a étendu au monde entier la forme de son hégémonie par la technoscience, par les aspirations de la démocratie et du droit, et par un certain type de discours et d'argumentation, l'Occident lui-même ne se reconnaît plus détenteur d'une vision du monde ou d'un sens du monde qui accompagnerait cette mondialisation, laquelle paraît le plus souvent se réduire à la domination de ce que Marx avait déjà parfaitement discerné comme la production du marché mondial. Le sens de ce monde paraît au contraire n'être que le sens de l'accumulation et de la circulation des capitaux, accompagné par l'aggravation de l'écart entre dominateur et dominé, et par une expansion technique indéfinie qui ne se donne plus que modestement et avec inquiétude des finalités de progrès, entre guillemets, et d'amélioration de la condition humaine. Notre temps est donc celui où il est urgent que l'Occident analyse son propre devenir, se retourne sur sa provenance et sur sa trajectoire, et s'interroge sur le processus de décomposition du sens auquel il donne lieu. Or, il est frappant de constater que, à l'intérieur du ci-devant Occident, s'il arrive assez souvent qu'on s'interroge pour les réévaluer sur la philosophie des Lumières, sur le modèle donc d'une progression continue de la raison humaine, ou sur la volonté de puissance du XIXe siècle conquérant, on s'interroge peu, en revanche, sur le corps de pensée qui organise, de façon matricielle ou directrice, l'occidentalité en tant que rapport au monde, je veux dire sur le christianisme.